And I don't see how, like, okay, he has the Cowboys on his list. They're in salary cap purgatory right now. They can't afford to sign anybody.
They're trying to sign Dak.
We can't even get our draft picks.
That's what I'm saying. You guys are trying to sign, desperately sign Dak.
He added the Ravens to the list. Now, I think the Ravens do have some money to spend because they got their franchise quarterbacks on that rookie contract, so I think they might have some money to play around with.
You might be right about that with the Ravens. I'm not sure.
The Texans,
I don't have a computer in front
of me
yet,
the Texans are on the list, but they had to trade DeAndre Hopkins just to get some salary cap room. The Chiefs are on the list. They're in the same situation. No money to spend. The Eagles are on the list, but they need more help at wide receiver than anything else right now. 49ers are on the list, and the Seahawks are on the list. Both all playoff teams, you know, so... I think he's going to have to wait on that contract. I mean,
yeah, I don't know who's going to really take it on, to be honest. I think he's going to be stuck with the Jets, so to speak.
He wants a deal that will make him the highest paid safety in the NFL. So that would exceed $15 million.
Is he worth that? I mean, do you?
No.
I mean, it is.
No safety is worth $15 million.
I
have problems justifying quarterbacks making $15 million.
That's not even my question. I know he's not worth $15 million, but do you think he's worth being paid as the number one safety in the NFL? That's my question.
I'd give him top five money.
I would say that.
But top five money for a safety these days.
I wouldn't give him overall number one.
Yeah, but top five safety money is what, $11, $12 million?
Yeah.
Not even close more than 15, which he wants.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I think he would get that kind
now,
of money.
Now, if they raise the salary cap, you know, if they raise the salary cap a little bit, I can see him paying a little bit more money. Everybody gets paid more money that way.
Yeah.
But you look at the way that salaries are escalating, you know, like Dak's not going to see $40 million, even if he goes 16-0 and wins the Super Bowl this year. He's never going to see $40 million. And he's asking for what? He wants to be the highest paid quarterback in the NFL, exceeding Seahawks Russell Wilson's $37 million.
And that's why I keep saying the Dallas Cowboys are not afraid to say, okay, you know what, Dak, we have Andy Dalton. You know, if you're not willing, I mean,
they have so much money tied up into their offensive line, and into DeMarcus Lawrence, and into Amari Cooper, into Ezekiel Elliott. They can't afford.
I could see if there's any kind of contract war with Dak, is what I'm saying.
Yeah,
that the Cowboys would say to him, "Hey, we're not afraid to move forward if you decide to hold out."
Yeah,
because that's why we got Andy Dalton. Because if you do pull us and hold out, hey, you're a backup then, and that might be what they tell him, and then they try and trade him next year. I mean, I'm just saying, but that could be what happens with Dak this year if they can't come to terms.
Tag and trade?
And is he going to hold out, though? That's my point.
Who would trade for him is my question.
That's what I'm saying. You're not going to find anybody this year that's going to trade for him.
If you look at the quarterback
landscape
right now.
He's
going to
be stuck there through another year at least.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If Dak wants to test the free agent market, let him, because there's really nobody going to sign him to the deal he wants.
That's my point. That's my point.
So let him test free agency, and then I'm telling you, he'll come back to that 3 to 5 year deal at $25 to $30 million, not at 38 to 40 million.
Yeah, I think it's being handled wrong, to be honest with you. I mean, slightly.
Oh, I don't. By who?
Dallas.
By Dallas or by Dak?
By Dak. Well, definitely Dak. I mean, Dak, I think, is asking for money that's just outrageous.
Yeah.
But if I was the Cowboys. But then again, I shouldn't say it's being slightly. I don't know how the Cowboys. Because if the Cowboys are handling it, like I just said, if they're going into talks with him and saying, look, you can ask for the moon for all you want. You're not going to get it. You're going to get what we can give you, and that's that. And if you're not down with that, then you know what? We've got Andy Dalton signed. He's been throwing BBs in the offseason. He's ready to go.
Yeah.
He's fired up about having these guys to throw to. And if you're not going to come start for us, he will. That's the way I would handle it with Dak and kind of play hardball back with him.
No.
He's playing hardball with you, asking for the moon on his contract.
Yep.
He's asking for Mahomes money. What has he done to earn that?
Yeah, see, I think
I'm just saying, has he been to a Super Bowl?
But he also, that's what I would bring up.
He gets
beat
in the playoffs every year.
This is what
far,
I would
right?
say to him. I was like, listen, during the regular season, you're fantastic.
But what happens to him in the playoffs?
But look at your playoff pedigree.
That's my point.
And you don't even have any Super Bowls to show for it. Even Super Bowl losses, even Russell Wilson's one for two in the Super Bowl.
That's my point. And he wants Patrick Mahomes type money. Yeah. And that's ridiculous to me.
You got to win.
So if I'm
show
the
me
Cowboys,
the
I'm going to come right back and play hardball with him. And I'm going to say exactly what I just said about, hey, I got a quarterback right here in back of me.
But
he's ready to go.
The thing is,
we're ready to go.
But the thing is, even if Jerry does find a way to sign Dak to even a $35 million contract, someone's going to have to go. And that's going to hurt the team overall, because either one of the offensive linemen's got to go, Zach Martin or Travis Frederickson or Tyrone Smith or DeMarcus Lawrence.
Not if Dak goes.
Huh?
I mean,
well, if Dak goes,
if Dak
fine.
Goes, then that takes care of a lot of open
Yeah, then Andy Dalton's your stopgap quarterback and you draft somebody.
Yeah, exactly. And then if he does win, then you know what? Maybe you do pay him another year to come back. But yeah, exactly. And then you draft a quarterback and start over.
I just got to remind Jerry Jones, Quincy Carter, Vinny Testaverde. Yeah, those guys did not work out in Dallas.
That's what I'm saying.
It's so hard to find a franchise quarterback. So when you got one, I think you need to lock him up. And in my opinion, Dak is a franchise quarterback.
I can agree with you on. I like Dak. I'm not saying I don't like Dak, but like I said, though, man, he tends so far, in my opinion, disappears in the postseason.
Yeah.
And to me, that's a big deal. But you've got to be able to win in the postseason
here's the thing
in order
on that.
To be a successful quarterback.
Here's the thing on that.
You can go down as a regular season, great regular season quarterback. Who do you remember as great regular season quarterback besides Dan Marino?
Exactly. But I'll tell you this. I don't pin that all on Dak because Jason Garrett was a very vanilla coach, especially in the playoffs.
Yeah,
you know, and I blame a lot of the Cowboys' faults on Jason Garrett.
That could up. You know what? You know what's a good comparison, actually, to be honest with you? And I'm just saying, at this point, I think he's still got a lot more to go to live up to the expectations. But Dak and Steve McNair, and especially with the way they were coached. Mm-hmm. You had McNair, who was coached for years by Jeff Fisher, who's a goon.
Yeah.
And now you got this almost the same thing with Dak's been coached by, what's his name?
Jason Garrett.
Jason Garrett his whole career. Mm-hmm. He's a goon. Yeah. You know, so you got, you know, in a way, you got two guys that were held back by their coaches in a way that were really great quarterbacks. And Steve McNair is a great quarterback. I mean, I'll argue that with anybody. Dak, I think, still has a ways to go to get called a great quarterback, but I think he's on his, like you said, he's on his way there.
Yep.
With certain things.
So. The thing, too, is I want to see how Mike McCarthy actually manages his team. Because in Green Bay, he only had to deal with one ego.
Yeah.
In Dallas, you're going to deal with multiple egos.
Egos on a wide receiver. You got ego running back. Yeah, you're a quarterback now who wants $50 million a year.
You got it on defense, too.
Well, not 50, you know,
Byron Jones. Yeah. You know, they lost him to Miami.
Yeah,
so,
that's what I mean.
You know?
Every position.
Yeah.
You're going to have somebody.
So now we're going to have.
Especially on
now that Byron's gone, I want to know who the diva in the secondary is going to be. Is it going to be a Duzier? I don't know.
But maybe that's why guys like Jason Witten are still around to maybe keep some of these guys.
Witten retired. He's done.
Did he re-retire again?
Yeah, he's done. Yeah.
I thought he was coming back one more.
Now, this is Blake Jarwin's time to shine.
Okay, well.
For tight end for the Dallas Cowboys.
Well, you know what? These guys got to come together after the Cowboys. I mean, that's the case. And Mike McCarthy, like you said, how is he going to handle it? I think there's a lot of questions with the Cowboys, to be honest with you.
All right, taking a look at our Tampa Bay Buccaneers, our local team here.
Yeah, let's do it.
Have they actually been on the field practicing? Have you heard any news coming out of Tampa Bay?
Other than the private workouts that they've had, I don't know what they've been doing, to be honest with you. The only thing I know is Tom Brady's been working out with the guys at high schools around Tampa.
Yeah.
Doing private workouts.
Because I'm the same. I'm not hearing anything.
Not hearing any kind of thing going on in Raymond James, or I should say the one. But,
and to be honest with you, I think that's a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, no one's out partying. No one's out getting sick.
And you know what? If Brady and the guys want to get together in their off time and go out and throw the ball to high school, and they've got it set up that way, hey.
Jamal Adams is seeking a $20 million plus.
Yeah,
year.
Not going to happen. Jamal Williams and $20 million. He's just throwing that down.
Jadeveon Clowney can't even get signed to $14 million deal.
That's ridiculous.
You know, he's still a free agent.
Dak had a hard time getting a $20 million offer from the Cowboys, and he's a quarterback.
Yeah. Apparently, the Browns did offer him a 2-year deal. That was the only multi-year opportunity he's gotten. Everything's been a 1-year deal for less than average. But the Browns offered him nearly. Oh, no. Okay, no. They have $40 million in cap space, so that's why they're trying to land him. They're trying to land him for $15 million. and he said no. But the Browns, didn't they just release Olivier Vernon? He was making $15.25 million cash.
They
should
have taken some kind of a...
But could you... A Myles Garrett, Jadeveon Clowney bookend, that would just look tight in Cleveland, I think.
Yeah.
Even though Cleveland's always a mess. But they did get rid of Freddie Kitchens, so that was
good. That's
what
I'm saying. They've made a little bit. At least they made strides in the right direction this offseason. But I don't know. I won't be sold on Cleveland until I see it, especially Baker Mayfield.
Yeah, well, I called it last year.
I still don't know what kind of quarterback Baker Mayfield's going to be.
Yeah, well, I called it last year. Remember, everybody was on the Cleveland Browns hype cheering, and I'm like, listen, these guys aren't even going to make the playoffs. I guarantee it.
Have you heard who is interested in Mr. Kaepernick?
I was just going to go there.
No.
Actually, I'm seeing a couple of teams might be interested in him.
San Diego.
I hear Seattle is a backup. One. But I think he could start in San Diego.
That's what I said. San Diego, to me, is the interesting one. I think he could possibly. His big-time competition there is Tyrod Taylor and Herbert, the rookie.
Yeah, and he's going to sit. I think he'll sit the first year.
That's what I think, too. I think that he will sit the first year. I personally think even without Kaepernick going there, he'll sit the first year. That Tyrod Taylor will at least start the season as the quarterback and go from there. Because apparently the head coach San Diego does like Tyrod Taylor quite a bit.
Well, he's 32. Kaepernick's 32 years old, but he hasn't played in the NFL since 2017. For running backs, that's a great thing. No rust, but I don't know if that's a good thing for a quarterback because you kind of need that accuracy. And I don't know. I would take a chance on him though because he is a guy who took his team to a Super Bowl, you know, and should have won it if the lights didn't go out in New Orleans that night.
Now I will say this: you asked me about the Bucs. I will say this: there is one player now that I'm really thinking about it that I did hear about who has been practicing and been throwing BBs.
Oh, yeah?
And I'm not talking about Tom Brady.
Blaine Gabbert?
Yeah. Blaine Gabbert, as they said, from what I've heard, and the workouts that he's been with a couple of the players, has looked phenomenal. So Blaine Gabbert, as the backup quarterback for the Tampa Bay, is actually maybe learning something behind Tom Brady as it is. Like I said earlier, Tom Brady's going to make everybody on the Bucs better, at least everybody on the offense, in my opinion, better. And you look at what he did last season, passes over 15 yards or more, he was still the number one rated quarterback in the NFL. And he did that without the receiving core that he now has in Tampa Bay.
Uh-huh.
And that's why I think times two, it's going to be even more joyous than it was last year and years before with Tom Brady, because now he's got weapons in an offense. And the big time question mark in my mind for the Bucs is, can they protect him enough?
Mm-hmm.
Can they fix the offensive lineup, which I believe they have. I truly believe they have, and I think they will go down as one of the they'll come out as one of the most potent offenses in the NFC.
One of the things I'm really looking forward to seeing though is the first time Brady gets sacked, because I love his expressions when he gets sacked. He gets up, he starts yelling at his offensive line. He's fired up, he's pissed off, and I just want to see how that rubs off on this offensive line, because I've never seen that from a Tampa Bay Buccaneer quarterback get angry like that.
I'm dying to see. I'll be honest with you.
Yeah,
to see a field general actually general the field, so to speak.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Like, really haven't seen that in Tampa Bay ever. I mean, you'd have to go back to maybe Steve DeBerg. You know, in those type of days.
Literally,
to get the emotional quarterback that we had.
Yeah, because
they never, even Trent Dilfer, I mean, he did it, but the timing of him with doing it was kind of bad, in my opinion, sometimes.
Yeah.
There were sometimes, he would get on guys at the right time, you know, hey, you should have done this when you were supposed to do that, you know, or you did this when you're supposed to do that, you know, whatever, you know what I mean. I've seen him get on guys about certain things that, you know, at times of the games, you know, in important games and whatnot when he was a Buck. So I could go back to a little bit with Dilfer, but for the most part, I haven't seen that a lot in Tampa Bay. And to see somebody as good as Brady do it, that is what I'm looking
for. No, I've seen the receivers get fired up. I've seen offensive linemen get fired up, but I haven't seen that come out of the quarterback position in quite some time.
And you can say all you want about Jameis getting fired up, but when did he ever really get fired up when it counted?
It didn't seem like
he always got fired up the wrong way.
And when it didn't look real to me. It didn't look genuine.
When he was trying I'm with you on that, too. I'm with you on that, too. When he was trying to be positive with the – it didn't look – but there were times where he'd throw an interception, and if it is the receiver's fault, he would just walk off the field and not say a word. You know, when Tom Brady would be up in your face. You know, hey, why'd you drop that ball? That led to the pick. You know, why'd you run that route like that? You know, you weren't supposed to run that route. Jameis, you didn't ever see him do that. Never saw him run up and criticize a receiver. So if all these interceptions supposedly were the receiver's faults, then why did he not show any leadership at that point?
No, good point. Now, I heard, I can't tell you what channel it is, but there's a Ken Griffey Jr. documentary coming out this Sunday. Did you hear about that?
Oh, wow, no, I didn't hear about that.
And I'm looking forward to that because I was a big Ken Griffey Jr. fan. Even though he played for the Seattle Mariners and the Cincinnati Reds, I was always a fan. You know, he was an 18-year-old kid coming up.
Really all we have with documentary or with sports nowadays are documentaries.
Mm-hmm. So they're coming out with one this Sunday. I'm trying to find out what channel it's on. Oh, it's going to be on the MLB Network. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking forward to this because Griffey Jr. is probably one of the most copied swings as a child. Everybody wanted to imitate Griffey Jr. There's only two things that bugged me about Griffey Jr. that for me kind of ruined his career for me. One, the trade to Cincinnati, or the signing going to Cincinnati as a free agent. I hated that move. Not because I'm a Cardinals fan either. I'll get to that later.
And number two,
the fact that he never got a chance to win a World Series, because I would have loved to have seen Ken Griffey Jr. win a World Series ring.
Yeah,
that would have been probably one of the coolest things ever.
When they got the time when they beat the Yankees, that was like in the playoffs. That was pretty big.
Yeah,
that was the biggest they'd ever really got for.
But injuries kind of derailed him a little bit going into Cincinnati. I'm not saying those injuries wouldn't affected him in Seattle, because back in those days he was playing in the Kingdom. Well, no, he did move to Safeco Field, but which was natural grass. But that natural grass, I think, would have saved him. We're moving to Cincinnati, playing on that turf for all those years. That's what really hurt him. Because Ken Griffey Jr., man, he played 110%. You know, he went all out. He crashed through walls. He didn't care, man. He was such a great defender. And people forget
and
about that, too.
And he didn't take performance enhancing.
No. He didn't even look like it.
He's skinny as a post. Not at all.
You know,
he looked all natural talent.
Yeah, he pretty much looked the same body-wise when he retired than he did when he came up as a 19-year-old.
Which is very unlike a lot of major leaguers.
Yeah, so I'm looking forward to that.
Did you watch the Sosa McGuire?
I have not.
I'll be honest with you. I watched it. I liked it.
Yeah.
It brought back memories of, you know, the thrill of that time in baseball, because at that time,